First of all, I want to, a big thanks goes to Mike and his team and Angela for bringing the 11th edition of this golf summit. I truly, truly enjoy being part of this summit because it's the greatest time where the world of golf can meet all together here in one place, and at such a beautiful resort with the BRG group support with Matt and Ann to host us is truly our greatest honor. So thank you once again. Well, with Mission Hills, 26 years seems like it just went by like a flash. And I honestly feel that I'm just warming up and that we are just getting started. You know, with our Golf and More concept, we have now grown not only with golf, we have also expanded into different arenas and industries, to education, to cultural, to different shopping, retail, entertainment, to all the different hospitality and wellness. It's definitely a golf and more one-stop destination that we are creating. And what Bob was just mentioning before, you know, it's either you do something new, this is what we have always been doing at Mission Hills, is either we do it the biggest or be the first to do it. And we are very honored to have a privilege, such a platform to help further promote the game of golf that we all love.
I mean, when you go there now, it's you turn it into like a mega like lifestyle entertainment complex right now. I mean, how many staff? I mean, can you tell us a little bit about the back office? I mean, how many staff has, you know, your team members and, you know, on a daily basis? I mean, it's amazing, Daniel. I mean, amazing.
Depends on the phases of our different developments. When we were building our Hainan development, we built 10 golf courses within 14 months, and we had a crew of 80,000 people, 60,000 during the day and 20,000 during the nighttime, 24/7 to complete the world's largest golf resort at the same time at the fastest pace. But permanently, we have around 16,000 employees, and then part-time-wise, there's another 10,000 that come depending on our projects.
At both locations?
At both locations, wow. Right.
That's amazing. And big time in junior golf right now. With your 25th anniversary coming up, I heard you're doing 25,000 juniors, giving them a special program. Can you tell us about that?
Well, we all know juniors are the grassroots, the foundation of our future. And with China's golf history being so young, over just 30 years of history, the parents are not natural golfers or they are not brought up with golf. So it really depends on the next generation. And with China's one-child policy, I keep on encouraging that golf is not only a sport, it's definitely a life skill that they can groom from the ages of 18 months to 99 years old, basically, and more. So basically, it's a life skill, it's a way to connect with people, and a business tool, a business language, where each person can use this to better their careers and their life circles and so forth. We all are fully aware of this. So that's why the parents are keen to equip the child with the very best skill sets. So that's why we came out with first building the world's largest facility, the largest different practice facility, to the Golf Academy aspect, you know, inviting all the top coaches around the world with Ledbetter, to Hank Haney, to Cindy Reed, and so forth. These are key things to the fundamentals to help to develop the game. Once they learn the skill set, it's through competition, through tournament that we grow their interests and their skills. So each year we host around 50 golf tournaments. You know, some of the tournaments are such as working with Jack Nicklaus together to create his one and only Asian tournament. Paul knows this very well. You know, how to, when Jack himself comes and support our event. And then also we do an all-girls tournament as well with Annika Sorenstein, where she comes every year to help to promote the game with us and share her values and working with the juniors and then providing them exemption spots to play into even professional LPGA events. So these are great, great golden opportunities to help inspire the next generation of golfers.
That's amazing, and you keep on coming up with these programs and ideas. You're leading right now. You're more than it's amazing. The government, there's been like rumors, like, you know, all over the world right now, there's golf courses closing down. I mean, but you just keep on going and going. I mean, can you give us your secrets?
There's no really secrets in any way, but I do think it's the perseverance, you know. There were over 100 plus golf courses that were closed last year. All of a sudden, one-fifth of your competition is gone. And I keep telling our members, at the end, it's not which club you play at, it's which club your friends are playing at that is the most important. When you have the critical mass, it definitely serves as a nucleus to attract a lot of the other fellow players to come united into one club and one facility. And definitely with the economy of scale, it definitely helps to drive the attractions of people coming together and wanting to play at Mission Hills.
That's amazing. Tanya, regarding your Haikou location, just can you tell us about what was the background and your thinking back then?
When we first started in Hainan, they haven't declared Hainan. A lot of people know as Hainan as the Hawaii of the East, and it's the only tropical island in all of China. And they haven't declared it to be the international tourism island. It was back in 2009 when they declared it to be this special economic zone where it became the international tourism island. What does the international tourism island means? It has 39 visa-free exemption countries that can fly directly into China without getting a visa. It has tax-free incentives. So definitely it has a lot of value shoppings for all the shoppers. So it's overall, from the climate, it has the best air quality in all of China. So PM 2.5 is all year round, it's all single digit. And the weather's perfect for golf, and with the visa free and all the different benefits and all the international flights that fly directly to Hainan, definitely is a very sought out destination for the China's 1.3 in population's backyard playground. Wow.
With the theme of the summit here, new direction, next 10 years. Can you talk to us about the next 10 years?
I think if we keep on just growing organically with the golf industry, we can still progress. But how is it that we have that big leap? This is what we have been doing to leverage on other sports. That's why recently we have partnered together with China Football Association to create the China, the national team's headquarters, where we are building 29 football pitches and having the football headquarters right at our facility. And at the same time, we also invited FCB Barcelona, the most favorite football team in the world and for Chinese football fans, to come and be aware of our facility and working with them. At the same time, with basketball, working with NBA to create another Asia's NBA headquarters, where we'll be building 20 plus basketball courts to academy, to NBA exhibitions, museum, and so forth. These are all things that we're trying to attract and have a crossover of different sportsmen. Different sports could connect with the game of golf. You know, these are all people that were not noticing with golf, all of a sudden, because they are fans of football and basketball, these are the biggest fan-based sports in China. Definitely has a huge draw for a lot of people to come to be aware of the game. And also, additionally, every 2 years we host the World Celebrity Pro-Am, where we invite all the likes of the biggest Hollywood stars to the biggest sporting athletes. You know, all the people that are non-golfer related audiences, all of a sudden they come and pay attention to what golf is about and why golf is hip and more fashionable to them.
Tanya, each year you come, or Ken has been here, and you've given some inspiring, let's say, information and just insight, which is amazing. This year, you've been getting an award about junior development. I'm excited about it because I do a lot also in Thailand. But when we look to your golf course, it's like you just do such fabulous, amazing marketing programs and with junior. Can you just tell us what has been working and what programs that you have more?
Oh, I think the most obvious contribution that we're doing for the world of golf is we made three of our golf, amongst the 22 golf courses we have, three of them are free for all juniors around the world that they can come and have access I think it's letting them onto the golf course is what really makes them excited about the game. Sure, the driving range is a nice tool to get introduced to the game, but once when you're on the golf course, everyone feels like a big kid and they can really enjoy. Just last weekend, I introduced something that is quite revolutionized in the game of golf. I created rugby golf, where we have rugby player using the rugby ball, teeing off, rather than teeing off, they kick off basically, kick the rugby ball, and then there are par threes, par four, par five, a similar concept. And we did this as well for football, as we all know about foot golf. So we created the first ever national foot golf, China Foot Golf Association at Mission Hills, where we formulated a national team. It's just getting the non-golfers onto the golf course. You know, we try every creative way possible just to engage them and excite them and let them have fun onto the golf course. And I think these are creative ways. It may not be the most sustainable, and no one can really afford to close the golf course to do this type of concept. But I think as a gimmick, as a way to attract more non-golfers to the game, these are things that we can engage. But in the long run, to make it sustainable, I think it's through leveraging the world of golf's different expertise and experiences that we can really grow the game together. And it's like these summits like this that we can get the chance to meet people like from PGA of America or different golfing association bodies, where we can grow together and to identify what are the needs to grow the industry professionally, grow the game through the junior to amateur to professional level, and ultimately to doing different wow factor events together to attract the golf enthusiasts to be more involved in the game.
Last month, there was an article in China. It's a sport for still for millionaires. Mm-hmm. You're basically changing that right now. I mean, how have you taken to that? I mean, is golf still just for the elite in China?
Well, with the history of golf, it has always started with the most elitist or the royalty, and then gradually growing to everyone's game. And so I think it's, in some ways, being the elitist game, it has its attractions, definitely has its barriers at the same time, but I think it has a more positive image because of the rich history of the game of golf and the values of the game, what it brings to a person's development, especially with our youth. Definitely, I think we shouldn't go against this trend, but instead embrace it and make it more accessible to the juniors, or, you know, whenever we host any professional tournaments or our touring pros that come and train at our facility, they're more than willing to work with us to help grow the game together, with Tiger's visit, to Rory's visit, to whatever we have happening on a regular basis. Definitely has a huge draw to have the schools involved. We do go into the local school community.
I was going to ask you that. Yeah,
to their PE classes, where we contribute our coaches' times to go and help. I'm sure you've done a lot of that as well, wearing your big straw hat, and they all say, "Hey, look at this funny guy. Okay, I want to learn something from him." Basically, it's engaging the community and making it fun and hip and enjoyable. It definitely is a daunting game when you're first approaching it, but how is it that you make it more interactive, and with snag golf and all these different mini putting games, definitely it has a lot of draw to get a lot of people's interest.
And I see that you're personally involved. I mean, you're always involved in these activities, participating yourself. How's your golf game?
Well, that's the irony. Everyone thinks just because you have the world's largest golf resort, you must be playing every day. But nevertheless, you know, I think if I probably pick up a set of PXG, maybe it'll help my game a lot more. And nevertheless, I think it's such a lifetime enjoyable game, and I do enjoy, embrace, and all the people that I meet on the golf course and all the wonderful things that you can do. Each year, we do around close to 400-plus charity golf tournaments at our facility. You know, almost on a daily basis amongst the two resorts, among the 22 golf courses, there's so many charitable causes that we can leverage on using the golf courses, and that's really been very beneficial to the community and for the country. And definitely, this is something that we are very grateful that we can help to contribute.
In Thailand, we see, I was there almost 20 years now, and I see they were like 8 years old when I see them, and now they're all the way past college. Only a couple of them have made it. One of them, our star member, is she's actually number one in area on the LPGA. But rarely do you see a lot of, they're going to like colleges, and after college, do you see the junior golfers in China going over and getting college scholarships? And have you seen that?
This is indeed one of the most biggest selling point, but I feel that every country can be applicable, is that positioning golf as an opportunity for higher education and scholarship. And this is one thing that we do share with the parents quite frequently, how this can encourage their golfing career. Because I'm sure a lot of the North America or in Europe, all the university, they would love to. There's so many unused scholarships at the same time, and they're looking for the right candidates and to have an Asian face. Imagine you have the next Yao Ming that's in golf that can be in your university. You know, these are the wow factors that can help generate the biggest marketing. You can call it marketing, or you can call it as a PR way to connect with the rest of the world. And we're so honored to see through our junior programs that many of the great professional players are succeeding, including now the current world number one LPGA player, Feng Sanshan, the Chinese lady. Now, also was brought up at the Mission Hills Junior Programs. Wow. I work with her father on a regular basis in the Provincial Golf Association, where he's the Secretary General and I'm the Honorary Chairman, where we do a lot of initiatives together. So it's wonderful to see now the current number one now is China with the ladies. Now the man has to do something. So we are waiting for the right opportunity to help groom. Just like Li Haotong, who is the number one China player right now that came in third in this year's British Open. They are up and coming. I believe if you provide the platform, provide the right pillars and fundamentals to help grow, definitely they will prosper.
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, it's been almost 12 years since our last formal interview, so this is a great time, and I really, really enjoyed it. Before we go, can you give the delegates here any information that you wanted to talk about Mission Hills before we leave?
I do believe seeing is believing. I'm sure most of you have visited Mission Hills, but please do come back, and definitely I'm more than willing to see how we can further engage and further to not so much just grow China golf, but in general our Asian golf development. And definitely I'm very looking forward and willing to see how we can collaborate together. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Don't move. Don't move. Rarely have I had the opportunity to talk to a superstar like Tennille, just as all of you need this opportunity. The question I have, Tennille, most of us don't have 22 golf courses. So all of a sudden, say I own a golf course that is dying, and we sold it to you. And you're talking about you want golf and more. What is the first thing you would do at my dying golf course to make it come alive again?
Right.
What's
good
that?
Question.
Yeah, yeah, because we're all trying to steal those ideas, right? Yeah.
There's one point that I want to share with you that we frequently do to connect with the world of golf. Currently, we have over 900 plus reciprocations globally. I think it's about the network of golf, how we can cross-synergize and cross-promote. Just to share with you, with the 1.3 billion in populations, China alone, the domestic travelers, with the domestic travel, they travel 3.6 billion times annually. This is just the domestic travel. But internationally, we all know they are the biggest consumer. As you know, recently, November 11th was China's Super Singles Day, they call it. But it was another meaning for a Super Shopping Day. In that one day alone, 24 hours, they sold over $25 billion of goods in just one day. Just that one platform where they have This breaks all the American whatever Super Black Friday or Cyber Friday sales. You know, when they all, I think the American, they had the Black Friday sales. The record was 4 billion US in one day. But China in one day, 25 billion. So how is it we tap into this consumer to understand the industry of golf and to engage them? Travel, tourism is a big, big part of the whole sports tourism. This is what we are trying to promote very strongly. And there's no better vehicle than golf that can promote golf tourism that connects. You know, every basketball court, every tennis court, every other sports is pretty much standardized. It doesn't make a difference wherever you go around the world. But golf, there's no same golf course in the world. And how is it that we leverage each other's resources and network to engage, and also with the professionals, not touring professionals, but the Class A professionals in accompanying different golfers' experiences to enhance, you know, like Tony bringing in different groups to go around the world. I think these are all things that we can add together to help promote courses that are less utilized in some sense. I think there's a lot of ways of synergizing.
So I'm going to ask Tony a question right now. Everybody out here wants a piece of that 1.3 billion market in China. We want to steal all the business that Mission Hills has. We want to spank you as our competitor. Tony, what is the one thing this community should do to attract more of the Chinese sports tourists to their clubs?
Many of you know that in Thailand, with the tourism, they cater to the Chinese. I mean, a lot of the Chinese market are coming. So a lot of golf courses that I've seen, and even a lot of the hotels and stuff, is like, we want to have their experience very nice, but everything's got to be translated. Mm-hmm. In Thailand, we've translated. The government had a big issue with trying to talk to the China government about when you come to Thailand, what type of, you know, etiquette and all types of, you know, fun stuff to do. So I've seen the software, like I call it the Chinese software element, Chinese golf software, where when the tourists come in from the airport all the way to the golf course or the hotel, and it's that experience. Right. And I've done a lot of these boot camps where they're coming from China, and it's amazing. Most of you may even know that I've done these boot camps where I include a Muay Thai boxing.
Oh, okay. Excuse me, the Muay Thai Moxie? Isn't that the stuff you drink?
No, it's a Muay Thai. It's with Bo Khao, and they come in. We have Chinese from all over. Right now, we've got two pros actually up in China, teaching and with a group. So we're moving a lot of the groups and membership, and just making their membership fun. Right. But it's got to be in Chinese. It's got to be, and they're so nice. It's amazing. It's great to have.
So Tenille, I'm looking at Mission Hills right now, and you talk about sports tourism. Now, there are some people who golf, but say my wife doesn't golf, and say we have 17 children, which we don't. What do you think a club should provide to attract the entire family as part of the tourism experience?
I think it's a high request to ask the club to invest and to expand as they can to provide all the necessary amenities. It's basically impossible. I'm sorry to say only Mission Hills is able to do that. Right. But what I'm saying is how we can leverage the local tourism board to engage, to further connect with them, to have different shopping tours, to experience cultural tours, to different aspects. This is how we frequently work with the tourism board and go on road shows with the government. Just like last month, we were in Moscow and flying with the government to connect a direct flight from Moscow to Hainan. You know, these are the things that we need to be engaging in, leveraging the local community and the resources to create this wow factor experience. And you're definitely right. Not everyone's a golfer. The whole family cannot be all keen. We wish they are, but nevertheless, there are many things that we need to be providing and arranging to ensure that the whole family has a full experience.
Let me ask one more question then. And as I'm looking at the audience, I know that yesterday during the tournament, Mrs. Na was one of the few women that actually played in the tournament. It was like a men's club, a fraternity experience. So I ask you, how can we get more women to play? Nobody is more progressive than Mission Hills when it comes to spreading the message about the passion for golf. What should our clubs do to attract more women to this fabulous sport?
You're absolutely correct. Again, you know, with all of our juniors right now, 60% is male juniors and 40% is all female. What I did last year was to celebrate. Did you all know that there's an International Women's Golf Day on June 11th? So basically what we did was I formulated an association called the Ladies Amateur Golf Association, having all the non-lady golfers to get introduced into the game of golf. So we had all of our coaches, you know, giving free clinics and regular, apart from golf-wise, there's also different lifestyle experiences and clinics that we do, or even from cooking classes to all the different activities to just make it more like a lifestyle club so that they can be more engaging rather than just plainly golf, golf, golf. And as the ladies, the number one concern with the Asian lady is the sun. It's all the tanning and protection. So nowadays with all the sunblocks to different accessories that can cover yourself and protect yourself from the sun, I'm sure definitely there will be more and more ladies involved with the game. And with now the current world number one lady player in the world is a Chinese, it definitely helps as a huge boost to help promote more ladies' involvement.
I'm looking at a creative future right now. I'm looking at Zach over here, Top Golf. And in the States, I find that they've got the buzz, if you know what I mean. Has Mission Hills considered doing something like a Top Golf experience that is a comprehensive pathway, if you will, to regular golf? Have you considered that sort of experience?
I think the more Topgolf is such a well-known brand and globally, and definitely this is something that is in need to help to revolutionize the game. And we are always very keen to know what is the latest and to how to engage it and to induce it. And then maybe even have a crossover with the Chinese cultural needs and experiences so that we can merge as one to help to elevate this whole concept. I believe it's a very well-sown concept in the UK to the US, and definitely we're keen to see how we can further expand this type of concept.
One of the most creative things that Mission Hills did that I remember you're doing is bringing foot golf in as one of the activities on your course. It's not just about golf course, it's about an entertainment complex. How successful has that been? Is that a trend that came and went? Or does foot golf have a place in a traditional golf environment?
We do, luckily, we do have a designated course just to do foot golf. It's one of our other, not included in within the 22 golf courses. There are regular plays and regular leagues that are happening, but nevertheless, is it widely promoted? I think my priority is still to promote the game of golf first. I think the foot golf to the rugby golf to all the different aspects that we're going to be merging together. Every celebrity event I host, I have them to engage with the game of golf. Just last month, we had Lewis Hamilton that came, and he was playing golf with Stephen Curry together at Mission Hills. You know, trying to leverage their mega, super big data to connect with the other their fans to the game of golf as well. I think this is something that we are going to be continuing to further to promote.
I'm so excited about what Mission Hills is doing when it comes to creativity. Mm. I happen to be an awful golfer, but I have more fun than anybody when I play golf. One of the things that I've looked for in golf courses, and again, I'm looking to Mission Hills as cutting edge, I love these tailor-made 15-inch holes because it makes me feel like I can play golf again. Is Mission Hills doing anything with 15-inch holes?
You're talking about the foot golf holes that we're doing?
No. I'm talking about regular golf.
Regular golf with 15-inch.
Yeah, TaylorMade has them. Fabulous.
Really?
Yeah, even okay. I putt well.
Oh, okay. Perhaps we should do 18-inch then. Chinese people
even
like
better.
The bigger the better. Right?
But have you tried that? Is that even something that you've considered?
I think anything to bring people onto the golf course and make it more easy and fun and entertaining, we're definitely up and ready to experience.
I'll ask one more question. People like me think about a 6,200-yard golf course is ideal. But a lot of people have these pros come on the course with all these PXG golf clubs, and they want a 7,300-yard golf course. What are your thoughts on the optimum length golf course to attract and retain members?
It's definitely a balance of the game, you know, with the skill level to the maintenance cost. There's so many considerations. The only best way is to have different sets of tees. So every golf course, we have five sets of tees, which make it
five,
from the red tee to the black tee. So there's red, white, blue, gold, and black. So basically, however far you want it, you know, we can cater to. And with the wide variety of the 22 golf courses, there are courses that are going to be extra long. The longest one is around 7,800 yards. Even Greg Norman thought it was too long for
him. How many yards?
7,800 at sea level, you know, at our high nine golf courses, to as short as, you know, 6,200. It really varies on your skill set level. I always recommend them to play whatever is comfortable with their skill set rather than just going for the abusing yourself on the golf course.
Have you found there's been a change in the number of holes people play? Are they playing fewer holes and enjoying golf, like doing more 9-hole than 18-hole, to get those people who are concerned about timing and the amount of time they have in their lives to actually play? Has there been a change in that market?
I think we do encourage them to complete the 18-hole. If anything, we set different handicap system on the golf course for the speed of play to ensure that lower handicappers can play quicker, you know, even if they want to play as a one ball or two ball or three ball. You know, I think it's setting different criteria with the different skill sets to monitor the pace of play to control. Obviously, there are still going to be people that still just want to play 9 holes or night golf. Typically, they do, if they want to play after dinner, they would just play 9 holes.
That's 6 or 9?
Nine holes.
Usually 9.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because they know if they play 6, they still have to pay for the same amount for the golf cart for 9 holes or the caddy fee. So they might as well finish the extra 3 holes.
Tony's jumping out of his chair. What is your question, Tony?
Rugby golf. Can you explain that a little bit, just in case?
Well, it's basically just using the rugby ball, and there's a shorter hose, and there's a big, basically a barrel that we have it around the hole where they have to toss it in at the end of, depending on the par 3, par 4, par 5 concept with the, but all of the tee off is with the kick, with the kicking.
And juniors only, or?
No, for all ages, right. I see that James wanted to ask a question.
James Prusa from Korea has arrived. But James, come up here. So, just a second. I want to make sure everybody can hear you, James.
Thank you very much. Tennille, you mentioned that you were in Russia trying to develop direct flights from Moscow to Haiku.
Yes.
Are there strategies coming into place with Hainan smack in the center of Southeast Asia to develop strategies for inbound from the rest of the ASEAN countries to encourage more inbound tourism? I realize the domestic market is massive, but stirring things up a bit and perhaps getting inbound from ASEAN, I'd be curious if there are strategies in your head for that.
Honestly speaking, you know, the government is very keen to not just capture the 1.3 billion tourism that will be coming to China, but it's an international tourism island. They don't call it the domestic tourism island for a reason. That's why there's 39 visa-free countries that are exempted to come to China. It will only grow more. Basically, typically, our team and myself do go with the government on a roadshow probably 2 to 3 times a month, if not more. A lot of times to different countries, even to the ASEAN countries, to align strategic sister cities to different tourism initiatives to help connect this gap. So I do believe that it will grow more, and hopefully, you know, with the different amenities that we can provide. Definitely, we're trying to connect the whole world together and vice versa, bringing our Chinese customers to other resorts. That's why we have over 900 plus network of reciprocations so that we can connect and let people experience the world of golf at the same time.
Tenille and Tony are going to be on the stage for 1 minute more, and that's all. Does anyone in this audience have a question they'd like to throw? Right here. Just a second. I'm going to run over here right now. You look like a man I know. Oh, there it is. You got a microphone. Yeah. Stand up. Who are you? Tell us who you are. Andrew Wood. Oh, there's another one.
There we go. All right, Andrew Wood. So the question I had was, in the States, there's a lot of mixed messages about golf in China. We've seen a lot of news. I think they closed maybe 66 courses this year, something like that I read. So there seems to be a very mixed message with golf in China, because they're building fabulous courses and they're closing them down just as fast. Maybe you could give us a little insight on that.
Andrew, you always come up with the best color jacket, blazer. I must compliment you that every year, you know, you always have a new wow factor. So, you know, I think a lot of the golf courses, it has to be closely regulated and monitored to have a sustainable long-term growth. You know, previously, a lot of developers use golf course as more for a property initiative, property residential development, rather than for the love of the game or for the sustainable growth. And they were making use of valuable farmland to using fresh waters and so forth that really concern the overall population. Obviously, we need to make sure we have enough rice field to feed the 1.3 billion before we start to play the game of golf. So I think this regulation, it was a good initiative from the government part to make it to have the better benefit of the sustainability of the growth of the game in the future. And like I said, but to us, it was almost like a blessing in disguise. It was more than 66, it was over 110 golf courses that were closed. But all of a sudden, we had one-fifth of our competitions were all disappeared. And then all of a sudden, they all wanted to join the club that they feel that it has the most secure and sustainable model that they want to be part of. So it was a blessing in disguise.
Ladies and gentlemen, let us give a rousing hand to Mr. Mission Hills and Mr. Black Hat right now.